So here we will learn something called Coriolis effect or Coriolis force. So Coriolis was a French mathematician who in the 1800s wrote down the mathematical expressions of the effects of the fact that we are on Earth, that is a sphere. So it's like a merry-go-round, except when you're on a merry-go-round, you can see that the buildings are standing still, or maybe your mom is standing there waiting for you. So you know you are on a rotating surface. But if you're on a sphere and there is nothing around and everything is moving with you, we don't know that we are moving on Earth at such a high speed, except if the Earth stops, just like the merry-go-round stops, you will go flying because you are moving with the speed of the merry-go-round, right? This has very interesting effects on everything we can think of, like winds, ocean currents, where the water comes up, where the water goes down, where the air rises, where the air sinks, and so on. So how does it work? Let's look at this figure. So we have Earth with an obliquity of 23.5 degrees in the current configuration. And we know that Earth is a sphere, which means that near the equator, the circumference is the largest. As you go away from the equator, the circumference becomes smaller and smaller, right? So if you remember that the Earth makes one rotation in 24 hours, that means everybody who is on the equator is moving much faster because they have to cover a larger distance in 24 hours. Whereas somebody, Santa Claus sitting at the North Pole, is making a smaller circle, so he's moving much slower because he's covering much smaller distance in 24 hours. So as you can see here, on the equator, everybody is moving at almost 1,000 miles per hour or 1,600 kilometers per hour. As you go towards certain latitude of 30 degrees north here, for example, we are moving only at 870 miles per hour and so on. At the pole, obviously, it's a dot that is not moving. What does this do to the whole system? So think of this way. Let's say we are trying to launch a rocket from the Galapagos Islands, which is in the Eastern Pacific, towards a city called New Orleans, which you may have heard of because it got hit by Hurricane Katrina in 2005. So this rocket is moving north because you launched it to the north, but you're launching it from the equator. So it's also moving eastward at 1600 kilometers per hour or 1000 miles per hour. So as it's going north, the surface under the rocket is moving slower and slower. So the rocket is actually moving toward east of New Orleans by the time it gets there, because New Orleans is only moving at 870 miles per hour, whereas the rocket has been moving eastward at 1,000 miles per hour. So essentially, the Coriolis effect has moved the rocket to the right of its direction of motion, which is supposed to be northward. You can do the same thing for a rocket that's launched. Let's say Santa Claus launched a gift packet for you from the North Pole. Because he's launching it at a very slow eastward speed and you are moving faster as you come towards the equator, the packet will lag behind you, so you will move eastward and the packet seems like it's going westward. So the same thing you can do in the southern hemisphere. If you look at the north, you are going from west to east. You can think of it looking from the pole and it'll look like you're going clockwise. Whereas if you look at the Earth from the southern hemisphere, southern pole, it's going counterclockwise, which means everything that is moving north and south will be moved to the left of its direction by the Coriolis. Okay? How does it work if you are trying to move from east to west or west to east? This is where something a bit more tricky happens. So this is just to confirm that if we are moving north, we'll be tilted to the right in the northern hemisphere by Coriolis. By the same concept, in the southern hemisphere, you'll be moved to the left of the direction of motion. That's very important. So if you are moving east to west, you have to remember what I said before. If you are standing on a merry-go-round, and let's say you are holding on, if you let go, you will fly off, or if the merry-go-round suddenly stops, you are moving with the merry-go-round speed, so you will fly off. That is called a centrifugal force. Anytime you are on a rotating surface, there is a force that is always trying to push you along a tangent And unless you hold on, you are going to fly off. It's like putting a ball on a merry-go-round and starting the merry-go-round. The ball will fly off, right? So that force is acting away from the axis of rotation, okay? So this force, if you have not done physics, don't worry about it. Basically, the force component can be split into a component that is in the direction of gravity towards the center of the earth, and a component which is again towards the right, whether you are moving into the west or east, okay? So essentially, because of this centrifugal force, even if you are moving east to west, there is a Coriolis effect that will push you to the right in the northern hemisphere to the direction of motion, and to the left in the southern hemisphere. What happens to the other component? Basically, that's in the direction of gravity, and it is about 1,000 times smaller than gravity. So we do not consider it. It's not very important. It doesn't have a big effect. You cannot really feel it, except theoretically, if you want to take off to space and you fly in this direction, then Coriolis will add a small gravity to your attempt to take off. So if you fly west instead of flying east, then that northward force will be against gravity, so the gravity will be slightly reduced. But as I said, it's reduced by about 1 in 1,000, so it's very, very small, okay? So we will use this Coriolis effect when we learn about trade winds. So when winds are trying to move, or ocean is trying to move on Earth, then they are always being deflected by the Coriolis force, okay? So later on you will have problems where you will have to combine your knowledge of the Coriolis force with the other knowledge of how the winds are blowing to see if the winds are trying to push the ocean, for example, in one direction, which way the currents will go. So if you have an iceberg floating in water, for example, and the winds are blowing, then which way the iceberg will go because of Coriolis? You will have to understand Coriolis very well to solve these kind of problems. This will also affect where the water comes up, as I said, where the air goes up, where the water goes down, where the air goes down, and so on.